Welcome to Learning English, a daily 30-minute program from the Voice of America. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson. This program is aimed at English learners, so we speak a little slower and we use words and phrases, especially written, for people learning English.
Today on the program, you will hear from Susan Shand and Brian Lynn. Later, we will present our American history series, The Making of a Nation. But first, here is Susan Shand.
A slowing Chinese economy and an ongoing government shutdown in the United States have some experts worried about possible damage to the world economy. China's economic slowdown has been a major discussion at this year's World Economic Forum, which began Monday in Davos, Switzerland. The Chinese economy grew 6.6% in 2018, its slowest rate in 28 years. Fears about China's slowing economy have been worsened by its trade war with the United States. But Chinese officials have said the country's slowdown will not lead to wide trouble. Feng Xinghai, who is with China's Securities Regulatory Commission, said China may be slowing down, but it's not going to be a disaster. Feng also told international leaders gathered in Davos that the structure of the Chinese government, where the Central Communist Party holds so much control, makes fixing the economy easier. And Chinese Premier Li Keqiang has promised the government would not let the economy fall off a cliff. U.S. President Donald Trump did not travel to Davos this year for the World Economic Forum. He canceled his trip last week out of consideration for the 800,000 great American workers not receiving pay during the ongoing shutdown, the White House said in a statement. The partial government shutdown has entered its fifth week as the standoff between President Donald Trump and Democrats over funding for a border wall continues. It is causing more economic damage than expected. Trump administration economists had first estimated the shutdown would cost the economy 0.1 percentage point in growth every 2 weeks that employees went without pay. But White House officials have increased that estimate to 0.13 percentage point every week. On Monday, the International Monetary Fund released its World Economic Outlook report. The IMF predicts the world economy will grow at 3.5% in 2019 and 3.6% in 2020. That is down from its estimates released last October, when IMF economists were already predicting slowing growth both in China and the United States because of trade disputes. IMF Managing Director Christine Lagarde told reporters, after 2 years of solid expansion, the world economy is growing more slowly than expected and risks are rising. I'm Susan Shand.
Netflix's movie Roma and British historical film The Favourite lead the Academy Award race with 10 nominations each. Nominees for the Academy Awards, or Oscars, were announced Tuesday. Roma and The Favourite will compete with 6 other films for the Best Picture Oscar. Among them is Black Panther, which became the first superhero movie nominated for the Oscar's top honor. It earned 7 nominations in all. Other Best Picture possibilities are A Star is Born, Green Book, Black Klansman, Vice, and Bohemian Rhapsody. Roma is partly based on the life of its Mexican director, Alfonso Cuarón. It earned nominations in every major category. Filmed in Spanish and an indigenous Mexican language, it will also compete in the foreign language field. Yalitza Aparicio, who plays a domestic worker for a family living in Mexico City's colonial Roma neighborhood, also earned a Best Actress nomination. Roma was 25-year-old Aparicio's first film. The Favourite is a humorous period film set in the court of 18th-century British monarch Queen Anne. It earned nominations for British star Olivia Colman and supporting actresses Emma Stone and Rachel Weisz. Greek director Yorgos Lanthimos also was nominated. Many of the films nominated for this year's Best Picture Oscar were among the top earners at the box office. That is different from most years. Members of the Academy of Motion Picture Arts and Sciences often favor smaller films. A Star is Born, starring Best Actress nominee Lady Gaga, earned 8 total nominations, including one for Gaga's hit song, Shallow. Bradley Cooper, who starred in and directed A Star is Born, will compete in the Best Actor category for the movie. But he will not compete in the race for Best Director. The omission surprised both fans and film experts. Another surprise omission was the humorous movie Crazy Rich Asians. The all-Asian film was popular around the world, but did not receive a single nomination. Rock musical Bohemian Rhapsody was nominated for 5 awards, including Best Actor for Rami Malek for his role as late Queen singer Freddie Mercury. Longtime actress Glenn Close, who has yet to win an Oscar, will compete for the 7th time. She earned a nomination this year for her lead role in The Wife. In the lead actor field, Malek and Cooper will take on Christian Bale, who plays former U.S. Vice President Dick Cheney in Vice, Willem Dafoe for playing artist Vincent van Gogh in At Eternity's Gate, and Viggo Mortensen for Green Book. Green Book also won a nomination for supporting actor Mahershala Ali. The Oscars ceremony will take place on February 24th in Hollywood, California.
Technology has already created many new educational tools to help teachers improve learning in the classroom. One method uses video gaming elements to get students more interested and involved in the subjects they learn. One American school using such technology is Dag Hammarskjöld Middle School in Wallingford, Connecticut. On a recent afternoon, about 20 children at the school watched a computer screen at the front of the room. The students were taking part in an educational activity that looks a lot like popular internet video games like Fortnite. The school children compete in challenges and can collect points to unlock powers, clothing, and pets for their players in the game. Unlike many video games, the students are not fighting against each other. Instead, the classroom games are being used by teachers to present different school subjects. The students can earn points as they pass through different educational levels of the game. Caden McManus is a 13-year-old student at Dag Hammarskjöld. He told the Associated Press he finds the game-based learning experience a lot of fun. He says working with pets is his favorite part because it helps him progress faster in the game. To train the pets, you gain as many gold pieces as possible, he said. Gianna Gerga is a teacher at Dag Hammarskjöld. She told the AP she had been looking for new ways to get more out of her students. So she decided to try a classroom gaming system called Classcraft. She says she has seen student improvements since she began using the tool in 2017. Her results even led other teachers to start using the gaming system. My kids are so addicted to it in the best possible way, Gerga said. With each correct answer, students receive points that can be used to buy things in the game. Points can also be exchanged for the chance to listen to music in class or take part in competitions against other classrooms. Students can also have points taken away if they behave badly. The Amana Academy in Atlanta, Georgia, is also using the Classcraft system. Teacher Laura Brewster says the tool has been an important addition to her classroom. Because it made me a participant with my students, she said. I'm not just their teacher, I'm their game master. I control the fun of the classroom. Student players can use their different powers within a game to cooperate so they have a better chance to succeed as a group. New York City Middle School Quest to Learn was one of the first public schools to launch game-based learning when it opened 10 years ago. Researchers have followed the school in an effort to measure long-term results of educational gaming on students. In the last school year, 43% of Quest to Learn's students met state requirements for students tested in English. This compared to 41% of students across the whole city. 29% of the school's students met state requirements after being tested in math. This was lower than the 33% citywide who met the state math requirements. But supporters of game-based learning say testing alone should not be used as the only measure of student results. Ross Flatt is Director of Programs and Partnerships for the not-for-profit group Institute of Play. The group uses game design elements to develop new learning experiences. It says outside studies have shown that students taking part in educational gaming do show growth in important areas. The main areas of improvement include student cooperation with each other, creative thinking, and empathy, the group said. I'm Brian Lynn.
Welcome to The Making of a Nation, American History in VOA Special English. Early in 1857, the United States Supreme Court announced one of its most important rulings. The High Court decided the case of a slave named Dred Scott. Harry Monroe and Leo Scully tell us about the ruling and the continuing national debate over slavery.
Dred Scott lived in Missouri, where slavery was legal. Then he was sold to a man who took him to Illinois and Wisconsin, where slavery was not legal. After 4 years, he was returned to Missouri. Dred Scott demanded his freedom because of the years he had spent in places where slavery was illegal. Congress had banned slavery in those places under the Missouri Compromise Act of 1820. The Supreme Court ruled that Congress did not have the power to close territories to slavery. It said the Missouri Compromise was a violation of the United States Constitution, and that Dred Scott was not a free man.
James Buchanan was sworn in as president at the time of the Dred Scott case. Buchanan believed the Supreme Court's decision would put an end to the dispute over slavery. He believed that Americans, North and South, would accept the decision as the final word in the dispute. This did not happen. The Dred Scott decision did not calm the storm that divided the nation. Instead, it increased its fury.
New trouble threatened to break out in the territory of Kansas between pro-slavery and anti-slavery settlers. In the past few years, the two sides had argued and fought over their opinions. They even had formed two separate governments. The pro-slavery forces controlled the legal government. The anti-slavery forces controlled an opposition government which had no power. Supporters of slavery wanted to organize a constitutional convention that could put Kansas into the Union as a slave state. The pro-slavery legislature passed a bill calling for such a convention. The bill gave supporters of slavery every chance to control the election of delegates to the convention. And it gave the convention complete freedom to make its own rules. The bill provided no way for the people of Kansas to vote on their own constitution.
The governor of the Kansas Territory, John Geary, vetoed the bill. But the legislature quickly overruled his veto. Pro-slavery men called for Geary to get out of Kansas. Some talked of shooting him if he did not leave. Governor Geary had been living under extreme tension for months. He had worked hard to keep Kansas peaceful. He was angry because he could get no help from the federal government. He sent his resignation to President Buchanan. Then the former governor spoke publicly. He said most of the settlers in Kansas were peace-loving people. He said only a small group was responsible for the trouble there. Geary said a few powerful men hoped to make Kansas a slave state. If this failed, Geary said, they hoped their actions would produce civil war.
President Buchanan appointed a new governor for Kansas. Buchanan told him that slavery in the territory must be decided on the votes of the people of the territory. And he said the people must be given a fair chance to approve or reject a constitution for statehood. The new governor arrived in Kansas at the end of May 1857. He explained his policies in a speech to the people of Kansas. The new governor promised to enforce the laws of the pro-slavery legislature, but only those laws which were constitutional. He urged everyone to vote in the coming election of delegates to the Constitutional Convention. He said he was hopeful that the convention would offer its constitution to the people for their approval or rejection. He added that Congress would not accept Kansas as a slave state or a free state until the people had voted on the question of slavery.
On June 15th, the election was held for delegates to the Constitutional Convention. Most anti-slavery men did not vote because their names had been kept off the voting lists by pro-slavery officials. Others refused to vote because they believed the election was unfair. 60 delegates were elected. All supported slavery. They planned to meet in the autumn to begin work on a constitution for Kansas. Most of the delegates were wild, rough men who found it difficult to read and write. But these men were sure of one thing. They wanted Kansas to be a slave state.
The delegates began the Constitution by claiming that the right of property was higher than any constitutional power. They said a slave owner had as much right to his property as the owner of any other kind of property. Then they wrote the different parts of the document. One part of the Constitution severely limited the right of the legislature to free slaves. Another part barred free Negroes from entering Kansas. And another prevented the Constitution from being changed for 7 years.
Most of the delegates to the Kansas Constitutional Convention wanted to send the document directly to Congress for approval. They did not want to give the people of Kansas a chance to vote on it. They were sure that the majority of the population would reject a constitution that made slavery legal. Some delegates, however, knew that Congress would not approve statehood for Kansas unless the people voted on the Constitution. The two sides finally agreed on a compromise.
The Constitution itself would not be offered to the people. Instead, the people would vote only on the question of slavery. They could vote for the Constitution with slavery or the Constitution without slavery. If the voters approved the Constitution with slavery, then Kansas would be open to new slaves. If they approved the Constitution without slavery, then Kansas would be closed to new slaves. Slaves already in the territory could be kept there. This compromise brought a cry of anger from opponents of slavery in Kansas. They said the Constitutional Convention had only given them the right to vote for limited slavery or unlimited slavery. It had not given them the right to vote for freedom.
President Buchanan had promised the people of Kansas that they would have a fair chance to vote on their Constitution. But members of his cabinet told him to forget this promise. They said Americans were tired of the dispute in Kansas and would accept any settlement. They told Buchanan that approval of the Constitution would end the Kansas problem. It would satisfy the South, they said, and the North would soon forget about Kansas. Under this pressure, President Buchanan made his decision. He would ask Congress to accept the pro-slavery Kansas Constitution and make the territory a slave state.
In Kansas, the vote on slavery was held. Most opponents of slavery did not vote. They were waiting until they could vote against the complete statehood constitution. Many of the votes were illegal. Still, Kansas officials declared that slavery had been approved. They urged Congress to make Kansas a state under this condition. Shortly after, President Buchanan sent Congress a similar message. Buchanan's chief opponent on the statehood bill was a member of his own Democratic Party, Senator Stephen Douglas of Illinois. Douglas did not oppose slavery, but he believed that the people of a territory had the right to make their own decision to accept or reject slavery.
Stephen Douglas united other Democrats and members of the anti-slavery Republican Party to fight against the bill in the Senate. He lost. The Senate approved the bill to make Kansas a state where slavery was legal. The House of Representatives, however, rejected the bill. Instead, it approved a bill to let the people of Kansas vote again on their statehood constitution. The Senate approved a compromise version of this House bill.
So the people of Kansas got another chance to show that they did not want a pro-slavery constitution. They voted and rejected the Constitution by a large majority. The pro-slavery statehood constitution was dead. Kansas would continue as a territory for a few more years, but there would be no further attempt to make it a slave state.
And that's our program for today. Listen again tomorrow to learn English through stories from around the world. I'm Jonathan Evans.
And I'm Ashley Thompson.